over the summer called Why Am I Here? And it's just a series on the concept of purpose. And the specific for this morning, why am I here? Last week it was why am I here on this earth? John 1, verses 12 and 13, and now John 2, 12 or 13 through 22. And why am I here in this house of worship? This is the story of Jesus cleansing the temple. John 2, beginning in verse 13. The Passover of the Jews was at hand, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple he found those who were selling oxen and sheep and pigeons, and the money changers sitting there. And making a whip of cords, he drove them all out of the temple with sheep and oxen. He poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. He told those who sold the pigeons, "Take these things away. Do not make my father's house a house of trade." His disciples remembered that it was written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." So the Jews said to him, "What sign do you show us for doing these things?" Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." The Jews then said, "It has taken 46 years to build this temple, and you will raise it up in 3 days?" But he was speaking about the temple of his body. When therefore he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. Father, we pray now as we turn to your word that you will bless your word, that you will apply your word by the Spirit. Help us, Lord, have the energy to do what you've called us to do in light of reading it. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, this past week, my thanks for the reading of a good article. It goes to two people, to Rob Milford and to my wife, for sending me along a Washington Post article called "Can Hipster Christianity Save Churches from Decline?" And at first we had to figure out what hipster Christianity was, because I don't consider myself a part of it. So as I read the article, I captured the spirit of the article, which I think was about the idea of trendiness in the church reversing the decline in church attendance. And I think the author got to the real point of the article in the middle, where he says, "Christianity's true relevance," this is in the Washington Post, by the way, "Christianity's true relevance lies not in the gospel's comfortable trendiness, but in its uncomfortable transcendence as a truth with the power to rebuff, renew, and restore wayward humanity at every epoch in history." And the author went through great pains to show that the survival of the church depends not on its looks, its outward sizzle, if you like, as much as it depends on people actually believing and living out the message. And that's where I started to really enjoy the article, because it really got back to, I think, a basic truth that we have talked about since we started our church, and that is the best advertisement for Parkside Church, Lake County, will be its people throughout the week, truly believing the message of the gospel and living it out in front of people who desperately need to hear it and see it. And so the article goes on, the author goes on to quote a self-described, lapsed, lazy, backsliding, and confused Christian. And this is what this person said: "I may be someone who cusses from time to time, who gets drunk, but that doesn't mean I want to be seeing those things where I occasionally worship. The point of church and faith is that they are sanctuaries from ourselves." His desire, this guy who he was quoting, is for a community that challenges rather than cozily affirms him and provides a refuge from, rather than a mirror to, the world. And as I read the article and read the author quote this emailer, I thought, you know, that emailer has a point. And that point is that as the church really acts like it should, it will become distinctly different from the world. And so as I was thinking about the next little installment in our series, you know, Why Am I Here? I wanted to think through a couple of things. One, as we ask a question like that, why am I here in a house of worship? This is a college, but at least for the morning, it's a house of worship. Why am I here in this house of worship today? The game-changing truth is that Jesus is central and supreme over all the earth. We explored this last week, and that will be a central tenet as we move along in this series. It is game-changing when you start to think about your own purpose as to why you're here on earth, why you're in a church, why you're in a relationship, why you may be alone, or why you might be struggling in your body. And those are the concepts we're going to think through. But you have to stop and start, first of all, recognize from what John is teaching is that Jesus is central and supreme over all the earth, including you. And once you come to that central truth, that will then help you formulate, I believe, in your mind then, why you are where you are in your particular phase of life, even if you like this morning, why you're here. And so I've chosen John chapter 2, verses 13 through 22, because I think what Jesus is showing us here is a contrast of what the old temple worship had become versus the new temple worship that was going to take place as him being central, him being the new temple, his body being the locus and center of all worship. It had become something, it was supposed to be something, and the definitive change that was going to really turn everything was the fact that he was going to rise from the dead, and he, in his own glorified body, would be the center of all worship. And so John chapter 2 helps us encapsulate this idea. So if you're a note taker, it's basically like there's just two pieces to this sermon this morning. There's old temple worship and what it had become, and there's new temple worship in light of Jesus' resurrected body and what it must be. And hopefully, as we kind of explore this, you'll start to see, or at least you'll start to come to answers maybe to a question, you know, why am I here? What am I supposed to be doing in this worship house, this service of worship time? And hopefully that will carry you through the rest of the week as you think about worshiping the Lord as you go away from this place. So just look at the first couple of verses here. The Passover of the Jews was at hand, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple he found those who were selling oxen and sheep and pigeons, and the money changers sitting there. Now what's interesting here, what had the temple become as you look at those verses 13 through 14? First thing you notice is that the sinner has become a customer in the temple. The sinner has moved away from being a worshiper and more of a customer. And this is what Jesus bumps into now as he's worshiping now in the Passover time. The temple, it's an important thing to understand what the temple is, the role of the temple in the life of the early church, especially in the first century. Gregory Beale in his book, The Temple and the Church's Mission, sums it up really, really quite nicely. He says, "The temple in its most basic sense is the place where God's glorious presence was manifested on earth to his people. The temple in its most basic sense is the place where God's glorious presence was manifested on earth to its people. Was built under Solomon, was destroyed, rebuilt under Zerubbabel, and then it was then redone again under Herod the Great. And it took close to 46 years to complete. Actually, at the time that Jesus was speaking here, it would take about 46 years, about 20 BC, and then going forward, take about 46 years to kind of redo, if you like, and then even the finishing touches continued on after that. Of course, the temple in Jerusalem was destroyed in AD 70 by the Romans after a significant uprising. But there were three purposes, basically, in the temple, if you go back to the Old Testament. First of all, it was a place where God dwelt. It was where God was with his people. Secondly, it was a place where sacrifices were made for atonement, where the people would come together as a nation and would make national sacrifices. It was a place also where there was a learning that took place about Israel's redemptive history. As the people told the story about Israel's history to themselves, they were to gain confidence that God was gracious and compassionate, but that he was also wrathful, and that he was a God of judgment against their sin, both personally and nationally. The temple was the place where the people continually reminded themselves of these things. But it instead became like Giant Eagle. It became like a supermarket. And even as I wrote that this week, like, I went to Giant Eagle yesterday, And I thought, those two things are totally incongruent to me. Like, can you imagine if we tried to take over a supermarket as a church, but we kept the supermarket? I mean, just think about the concept. Like, where is the worship service? It's in the produce aisle. Oh, great. Well, is that 10 or 11? No, that's 1 or 2. Oh, okay. Well, what about, like, the cold cuts and stuff? Oh, that's where the children's ministry is. Now, think about it this way. Because we're so advanced, I mean, all the animals that, you know, they're basically dead, that, you know, that are, like, ready to eat. But in Jesus' case, they were alive. So it was like a living giant eagle that had become the temple. And in some sense, it's, you know, it's sad. And in another sense, it's kind of crazy to think about. But when you think about the outer courts that were set up for the worshipers to come, they had been replaced by stalls. Now, I don't hang around a lot of oxen and sheep, but I know they're messy and they're loud. You know, when Jesus said, you know, get these pigeons out of here, I know what he was talking about. Pigeons are kind of annoying. You know, they're always in your face. They always want food. The point that I think was starting to happen, what was starting to take place, was that these stalls and all the accoutrements that came along with animals had just basically crowded out and taken everything over. It looked like a gigantic Sam's Club in the first century. The outer courts reserved for the people who would come in contrition. They actually served people like customers. The money changers had taken up residence as well. They performed a service where a temple tax would need to be paid for the worshipers that came in. And so as worshipers came from all over the world, they would come and exchange their currency so that the proper money could be exchanged for the temple tax. Now something was happening, slowly but surely, in the worship in the temple in Jerusalem in the first century. Animals that were needed for sacrifice, we could take nothing away from. That was part of it. But for the people, instead of having to bring those animals over a long distance, basically the people said, oh, we'll make this much more convenient. We'll have the animals right here for you. Instead of you changing your currency somewhere else, we'll put up the ATM right here. We'll put up the money window right there. And then you don't have to trouble yourself. We will make this really, really easy for you. And when the sinner became the customer, convenience for the customer reigned. And as convenience reigned for the customer, who was seen not as a worshiper, but as a consumer, well, then at that point, the profit margins start to expand. How can the money changers make a little bit more off of their side business? Well, they can charge a commission. Well, there's a person who puts the oxen in the stall, but there's also the guy who cleans the stall. There's the lady who tends the animals. And it just starts to bubble out from there. Once the worshiper is seen as the customer, the sinner as the consumer. And you can see that how easy it is to erode the line between faith and commerce. It starts to erode very, very quickly. J.C. Ryle, in his commentary, says, how easy is it to bring your outward appearances, your things, your goods, and your money, but not bring your heart? And my little attachment onto that quote is, how easy it is for the temple to accommodate you as the customer rather than the worshiper. How easy, in a kind of free market setup in the first century, is it for people to take advantage, especially the leadership in those Jewish circles? So the sinner is the customer. And when the sinner is the customer, then, they are the ones making the demands on Messiah. Listen to what they say. After Jesus takes the whip of cords out and drives out all the oxen and sheep. Verse 18, so the Jews said to him, what sign do you show us for doing these things? It's amazing here. And all this chaos has taken place. They're unfazed. They are, if you like, the ones that are serving the public. They are the ones that are making the demands on Messiah. You see, Jesus comes, and the people don't recognize it. Because the sinner is the customer. The customer is always right. And what's that taking place now with Jesus coming is he's basically destroying the status quo here and doing what he's doing. He's forceful in his objections to what's happening in the temple. He makes women violent, drives out the animals. He overturns all the money tables. This is the meek and mild Jesus that we normally have in mind. It's the righteous and indignant, wrathful Jesus who will come again. Zechariah 14:21 says that in the coming of the day of the Lord, quote, no longer will there be a merchant in the house of God. But see, the Jews who are there, they don't get the lesson. But what they had learned growing up is not computing. Because something else has taken hold. They are the authority. They are the ones making the money. Jesus is the one who's actually upsetting that. So they have the command of Jesus. You think you're in authority, Jesus. What sign do you show us that you are the authority? See, the customer is right, Jesus, and you are wrong. But see, that's what starts to happen when the sinner becomes your customer. Worship becomes a business. They don't even recognize the Messiah. They never talk about it. What's more talked about is the convenience of the people who come to worship and the money that needs to be made. But when faith, the line between faith and commerce starts to be eroded, the priests assume the authority, the business becomes the temple, and money drives everything. The Messiah himself receives the demands of the people so that they might actually stay in authority and not let him be the authority. You see how that cascading effect happens? What's crowded out is the fact that Messiah is here and the lesson that they had learned in that very temple. They're missing it because there's something else on their mind. The sinner is the customer. The Messiah has the demands made of him. And thirdly, instead of the temple being the place to learn and worship, it becomes the place that's practically worshipped by itself. The temple, in its original intent, was a place of learning. In the Passover, it was a place where people were to come and to think about the fact that God had judged people who had stood against him and that God had rescued them in the Exodus. It was a place to sit, ruminate, think about deeply how gracious and compassionate God is towards people, but at the same time, how he is wrathful for those who oppose him. And what had begun to happen slowly but surely in the temple was that ritual had started to overtake actual learning. People would come and pay the tax, make their sacrifices, and leave, and lives would not be changed. As the Jews are starting to come to grips with what Jesus is saying, you can almost hear the kind of the incredulity of the voice. Can you believe this guy? The Jews then said, it's taken 46 years to build this temple, and you raise it up in 3 days? I mean, look at this place. It's one of the most amazing structures in all the world. Look how many years it took to build this place. Our livelihoods are tied to this thing. Because something starts to happen when the sinner is the customer, the priests are the authority, and the Messiah is made demands of, and learning goes out the window. You start to actually worship the physical thing that you can see rather than the Messiah who has come. In our case, it is easy to worship a building and a structure and not the Messiah that you cannot see. So much easier to do that. As we look at a text like this, the reminder from Psalm 69 becomes very, very helpful. Because the temple is the place where people are supposed to learn. And the disciples got it. He told those who sold the pigeons, take these things away and do not make my Father's house a house of trade. His disciples remembered that it was written, zeal for your house will consume me. You see, the disciples, even though they had their clueless moments, it was in a little, the synapses were starting to connect. I remember Psalm 69, they said to each other. Do you remember it's about the righteous sufferer who would come and be opposed by his enemies? That he would be zealous for the name of God? Do you remember when we learned that in the temple? Well, that was the lesson that they were starting to come to mind. The learning was really actually starting to become, if you like, the living. Because it was all starting to unfold right in front of them. David's son, his eternal son, would come and be consumed by the preservation of the honor of God's name, not the preservation of the physical space. And so you start to see the difference. And the irony is that the very enemies that were talked about in Psalm 69 were the very people that were of his own background. They who were of the leadership of the temple were the enemies that stood against the righteous sufferer. And again, when you start to think about it, how easy it is, how very easy it is for ritual to overtake the whole reason why you've come into a house of worship. To think that by walking just through the motions, okay, I did it this morning, as if somehow there is some kind of magic in just simply walking through the exercise. And I think what had started to take place in the temple in the first century was just a long line of many years of families and generations who had made the attendance in the temple a thing without actually thinking deeply about the meaning as to why they were there. And so it just was handed down from generation to generation. Hey, look, listen, son, this is just what you do. All right? We'll get back to life, but this is what you do. Why do we do this, Dad? Don't ask that question. Just do it. And so Jesus confronts years of the place being worshipped, the ritual being worshipped, rather than God being worshipped. And so as Jesus is in the temple confronting what he's confronting, the last piece of verses 23, 24, and 25, the little editorial comment by John, I think starts to make more sense. I don't think it's in the bulletin, and I think I stopped short at verse 22, but I want to read it. Now when he was in Jerusalem at the Passover feast, many believed in his name when they saw the signs that he was doing. But Jesus, on his part, did not entrust himself to them because he knew all people, and he needed no one to bear witness about a man, for he himself knew what was in man. In other words, the bleeding was easy when the temple was made for the person, the customer, the sinner as the customer. And when you make demands on Jesus, belief really is something where you can agree with facts, but it's spurious at best. See, Jesus knew it was in the heart of people who had made demands of him to see a sign, and then they would believe. There's just something so different from that kind of person versus the person who falls at his feet and says, I can't see. I'm an outcast. I'm awkward. I have no other recourse but to fall on my face before you. I believe. There's something so different from the kind of person who comes in utter dependence and the kind of person who agrees with the facts and says, yes, as long as you show me a reason to believe, then I'll believe. In parentheses, but if you don't show it to me, I won't believe. And so you see that with the sinner as the customer, then, it's easy to believe for many. Because Jesus just performed the function that they want. And that's why Jesus didn't entrust himself to those type of people. Because their professions were spurious. They were shaky. They were like the seed that grows up and gets choked. It goes away very quickly. We talked about this for the longest time, but there is a gigantic difference between a profession of faith and a possession of faith. We start with the profession. We pray, disciple, faith, learn, and worship with, and pray like mad for a true possession of faith. And at the end of verse 25 something, he needed no one to bear witness for him, for he himself knew what was in man. God knows. God knows. We may not, but he does. David Wells, in his book of All Earthly Power, says he's got a really good section that I think built a bridge between what's happening in the temple in Jesus' day and what's happening in the church in America in our day. When the church takes a business type approach to appeal to a niche market of worshipers, this is what David Wells says. The question they are going to have to ask themselves, supermarket type churches, is whether the clientele they have courted have the kind of casual relationship to biblical truth and the low commitment to guarantee that their churches will go the way that many mainline churches have gone. If they cannot clarify for themselves who is sovereign, God or the right religious consumer, what is authoritative in practice, scripture, or culture, and what is important, faithfulness or success, they will find themselves walking the same road and facing the same fate as the churches that have failed before, because whatever seriousness now remains will dissolve into triviality. Basically, what Wells is saying is this. If the church becomes a supermarket, or if it becomes like a business where the sinner is the customer, then the church will, by nature, have to go out into the marketplace, figure out a niche, and reach that kind of person. And Wells' very important comment is that if you go and you get that kind of customer, that clientele, who doesn't have any concept of authority or commitment, and you get them to come in, don't be surprised when the substance that you have so worked for dissolves into basically triviality. Because that's going to be what happens. And things will collapse. Now, I was talking to somebody over the weekend who was telling me about their experience in a large mainline church. And they said, you know, nobody comes anymore. Nobody comes. And they were talking about one of the big outreaches they had, which was the protesting of Chief Wahoo. And we were laughing, because we were like, nobody wants to do that. Like, everybody loves Wahoo. Well, most people do anyway. And she was saying, boy, that's like the last thing we want to gather around. And I said, yeah. Like, I wouldn't go in the stadium. I don't want to stand outside of it with a big circle and a slash through it over Wahoo's face. But that was the kind of thing that they were using in order to sort of galvanize. Maybe in some kind of attempt to show another culture that they respect that culture. And that's not a comment on that. As much as it is a comment that this lady was making about her own church and lamenting the fact that the attendance had declined to the place that it declined. See, if you're trying to mirror the culture by saying, basically trying to take up every part that they take up, well, why would anybody want to go? I mean, why would you want to spend your time there saying, when you can just do something else? Why not just go to the game rather than protest the game? And the point that David Wells was making here is that basically, if the church goes down the road of making these kinds of decisions, then it shouldn't be surprised that it implodes. Because it's just going to take on the values of the kinds of people that they're trying to bring in. But to go back to the article, the hipster Christianity, even the people who are on the outside are saying, you know, this thing isn't really working for me. I want to choose a church where the people are actually trying to live out the message. Now the church offers something. It's not even about the building. It's about the people. It's about the people who are actually taking this very, very seriously. And irrespective of age, economic background, race, what have you, the gospel transcends all that. And the people are taking it seriously. And this is something that we have to come to grips with. Hopefully that's the kind of thing a person is realizing. Like, what these people are, they're kind of nuts, but they really believe what they believe. And it is different. So as we look at what the temple had become, and what worship must become in light of the new temple of Jesus' body. The new temple of Jesus' body. The sinner is not the customer, but the contract worshiper. Why am I here? Why am I here? Well, first of all, you are here, in a sense, because you recognize the utter inaccessibility that you have to Jesus before you've come to faith. And you recognize that, as a sinner, you are separated from God, and that you truly had no means to be in a relationship with God without the shed blood of Christ. If you think about the purpose of the temple, what it represented for the people who came was the utter inaccessibility of God. It could not go into the Holy of Holies. It was a place that was forbidden. But now, in the coming of Jesus, the curtain has been torn in two. There is an accessibility now to God through him. And so the person who has a contrite heart, who recognizes that God saves those who are accustomed to spirit and comes close to those who are contrite in heart, will then start to say, you know, my approach to worship begins in contrition. It begins in humility. It begins in understanding that God didn't love me because I was lovely. He loved me in spite of the fact that I was very unlovely, which makes his love even that much more unbelievable. Because when I truly look at myself, I think, oh, why would God want any part of this? And that will hopefully then start to breed contrition, not a sense of consumerism, but thank you and gratitude. The sinner comes into the house of worship asking not, what will I get out of this, but actually rather, what has God given to me in Christ? And if I come to understand him by faith, then the question really is, what may I pour out for him, others, as a thank offering? The equation completely changed once you see Jesus on a throne and you truly understand and apprehend by faith what he's done for you. Your approach to worship isn't necessarily, what is this for me? What's in it for me? It's not about you. It's about him. Once you come to that realization that it's all about him and it's not about you, the hope is that humility then starts to congeal. Contrition starts to become real. I know that when I read Psalm 51, I am so thankful that he has blotted out my transgressions, but I cannot escape them from this past week. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. So the sinner is not the customer of the contrite. Secondly, it's not the sinner who makes the demands upon the Messiah, but the Messiah who makes the demands upon the sinner. This is what he says. Take these things away. You see, he's starting to make the demands. So the Jews have said to him, what sign do you show us for doing these things? They make a demand, and he comes back and makes a demand of himself. Jesus answered them, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up. He's made a demand unto himself, that he himself will live the perfect life before his heavenly Father, and he himself will be the innocent one, the atoning sacrifice, and he will rise by the power of God to new life. He will do it. He makes the ultimate demand of himself. Destroy this temple now, it will be raised up in glory, and only he can follow through with it. Worship is acceptable because he follows through with the demand of perfection. And because of the resurrection, he is the authority. Now think about that. Because of the resurrection now, he is the authority over heaven and earth, over sin and the devil. It's all about him now. He has met the demand of perfection that you and I cannot meet. And that is an awesome thing. Because now when we come into worship, we recognize that it's Jesus in whom we make our plea to. He is the one who is interceding for us. He's the one who's met the demands. And we've got to be so careful that before we start coming before him, asking him to meet our demands for financial help, for physical help, for job-related help, for stress-related help, that we not first think about the fact that he met the demand of perfection I could never meet. He did it. And part of our intercession and coming to worship is the corporate, continual recognition that he's met our greatest need, a demand that we could never meet. When Jesus says in Matthew 11:29, take my yoke and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. The service of worship is a time to learn together about the one who is lowly in heart, who met the demand for you. And so you too can go out by faith and gratitude and be lowly in heart and meet the demand of a dying world, because you're doing it in and through the one who made and met the demand for you. And that's gospel. The new temple, then, is the place where you respond to Messiah's demands. That you see worship as done in contrition and not in consumerism. And thirdly, that the new temple is the place of worship through learning the scripture. The Jews then said, it's taken 46 years to build this temple, you will raise it up in 3 days? But he was speaking about the temple of his body. When therefore he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. The disciples caught the lesson in Psalm 69. They didn't quite catch at that moment the lesson that Jesus was teaching about his resurrection. The fact that his body would be really the new temple didn't make sense. But it did 3 years later when he actually rose from the dead. So think about it. He taught this, and that truth lay dormant for about 3 years, right? Just sat there. What's he talking about? I don't know. Think about what you teach kids. Think about what happened this past week. We're teaching kids over and over and over the gospel. And 15 responded positively, and 85 didn't respond at all. But 85 plus 15, you think about 100 people, 100 kids have heard this. The scripture is there, the seed has been planted, and what God does is glorious. He makes it grow. He brings recall to those things a long time later. Never think that your sowing of the word is in vain. Don't ever think that. If you have taken pains to connect with kids, older people, whatever it is, and you've shown them the scripture, you've read the scripture to them, you've gone over and over and over again, the Lord's word will not return in vain. I'm not saying that every single person that you speak the scripture to will become a Christian. What I'm saying is that when you sow that eternal and powerful word, the Holy Spirit uses that. I still remember some of the songs I sang in the Baptist church I grew up in. And it didn't make sense to me until I was in college when I really became a Christian. And now they come back to me when I'm reading the scripture. I'm not going to sing it, because then that'll like destroy the song. But it's amazing the power that God has through his word. And if you think about it, the temple is the place for learning. You know, we talk a lot about serving with kids, and it's like, oh, I don't know what to say, I don't know what to do. I don't know how they're ever going to learn anything from me. But the point is not about you, it's about what's being spoken to them that has eternal impact, and you can play a part of that. Can you imagine being reunited with a kid a million years from now in heaven, and they said, you know, the very first thing I ever heard about Jesus was from you. And just think about the kind of worship that would take place. Me? I don't even know what I said. That's exactly the point. All of that. But in the middle of that was the gospel. And that's the thing that God used to make stick and grow. And when you think about that, as the temple is a place of worship, it's a place of a recognition of being contrite, a place where the Messiah makes demands upon his people, and his people respond in loving obedience, then faith is not necessarily an easy thing. Belief isn't an easy thing. It's quite a rigorous thing. Belief will deepen as you trust in him who prays for you. John 17:8-9, this is where we'll finish. John 17:8-9, Jesus says to his Father, "For I have given them the words that you gave me, and they have received them and have come to know in truth that I came from you, and they have believed that you sent me. I am praying for them. I am not praying for the world, but for those whom you have given me, for they are yours." Your belief will deepen as you trust in him who prays for you, who intercedes for you. If the Father has given you in him, if you are in the hand of the Father for the work of Christ, then the most important thing that you can remember is the fact that Christ is your advocate. He's on your side. Belief is rigorous. It's straightforward, but it's rigorous. It takes a lot to truly trust in the Lord through each day of your life. But remember, the most important thing is not the sincerity of your prayers, but the fact that Jesus is praying for you. And that those he's promised to give to the Father, he indeed will do it. You come to the temple to remember that it's more important to trust in Jesus than yourself. It's a continual, perpetual reminder that if you've gone through a week where you've trusted in yourself, you don't see yourself as the customer, but as the contrite worshiper. Thank you. You don't see this place as a place to be worshipped. You see him to be worshipped. You don't learn because it's the ritual thing to do, but rather because you want to deepen that faith. And you recognize as you leave a place like this in humility that believing is not necessarily an easy thing. But it's the most important thing that we can do as worshipers, is to deepen our trust in Christ. The end of the Hipster Christianity article goes like this. This is where the author, Brett McCracken, takes us. I'm going to stop with this quote. He says, "Further time will tell whether the legacy of hipster Christianity, the phenomenon, will be one of decline or revival for churches. My guess," he says, "is that sooner rather than later it will become clear that what people want from church is something different than what is offered on the pages of Vogue. Most don't want a sceney bar or a stylish boutique. They want the church to be the church, an institution that embraces awkward people, confronts sin, transforms lives, subverts the sovereignty of self, serves others, and provides meaning more substantial than the ephemera of fickle fads." That was in the Washington Post. Thank you, Washington Post. Not just for the end of a sermon, which you might be thankful for, but rather for just the basic truth that the reason that we're here is to look different, to look like Christ. And the more we take time to do that, the more I believe the church will really become a kind of sweet aroma to people in whom the Holy Spirit is moving. And it's our job to go be the church in front of them. And of course invite them in. Yeah, I want as many people from the outside in here as God will bring. Do not get me wrong. But hopefully for those who have apprehended the message, they're figuring it out that the most important thing you can do is to do the rigorous work in the soul and come into a place. Why am I here? It's to worship Him. I'm not a customer. I'm a contrite sinner. And I need Him more today than I needed Him yesterday. That's why we're here. Tell each other that story. Let me pray. Lord, thank you for the fact that through this very jarring episode of Scripture, this picture of Jesus that we don't normally think about, that you've included it in the Bible so that we might be struck by it, its force, and that we also might be struck by the fact that now that Jesus is in heaven glorified, He is the locus of all worship. He is the center. Help us to turn our eyes to Him today in faithfulness. We thank you that we can do that together, and we pray that you'll help us now as we go out in song. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I'm going to stand and sing one last song.